once again, a couple jungle bans coming down, the Graves and the Olaf.
Yeah, Graves banned out to keep that one away from Wiggly. And of course, the Olaf banned out means you can't have super control of the top lane with the Aatrox, as well as insane control of the jungle with that Olaf. Akali will be the final ban of this game, coming out from TLA. CLG Academy now. What do you pick? Do you go for the jungle? Do you leave the mid lane for the last pick? You would think you would want to counter pick mid lane, considering how bad things were last time. You want to give yourself every advantage there that you can find. And it looks like they grab the Trundle for themselves. You can't stoppy the poppy with the Trundle if you've got the Trundle yourself.
Yeah, and it's a weird interaction where TLA probably, once again, not going to end up with too many tanks, as for the most part, it's been their support or their jungler with a tank. Hard often picks up that slack, but maybe with the Galio pick, it'll make the Trundle a little bit better. And of course, it's a nice takeaway if you're going to be running Poppy to not have the Trundle there to steal stats. So I like what CLG did. The Galio blind is interesting. We'll see what they run with it.
Galio picked up for Insanity. We've already talked about how this seems to fit the bill for what he's found success on earlier on in the split. Team Liquid Academy, who do you go for in the jungle here? That could be a very juicy Trundle target if they go for the Sejuani, but...
Yeah, it looks like they'll flex it over. Ooh, the Talia!
Okay.
This is interesting.
Switching it up at the end.
Yeah, getting a little bit faster paced. Tempo jungler also doesn't quite have the same struggles into the Trundle, stealing their stats away, so that makes a fair amount of sense. And this is a lot closer to the TLA team comps that we've been seeing for the majority of the season. They have a split push, carry, fighter threat in the top lane, and Insanity picking something to support that and be able to get up there and help as well. And a lot of time, Hard kind of fills in the gaps of the team, taking whatever they need. And now it's a similar team comp to what we're used to seeing. This is kind of their bread and butter, where it's a lot of diving side lanes for TLA and using their globals that they often take around the mid and the jungle to get up to Viper.
And in game number one, you mentioned CLG Academy playing double marksman, having the Varus and the Graves. Well, this time around, they're playing double marksman with Varus and Corki in the mid lane for Tuesday.
That is surprising. I don't think there's been any Corki changes recently.
Nope.
My memory does not fail me. And there was a period of time where Corki was seen as pretty good into the new Galio, because you basically just got to clear the wave against him equally well, keep him pushed in, and then just kind of auto-attack him down. But, you know, it doesn't seem like a Tuesday champion. Haven't seen it in a while, so we'll see what he can do with this Corki pick that he's busting out for the first time. Definitely going to be checking the runes, seeing what he's running on that champ.
Means he'll have plenty of firepower from range as long as they can keep them protected. Once again, CLG Academy has this squad with a Poppy, a Trundle, a Braum, these big meatballs. Lots of poke in the way for those marksmen. Exactly, the piercing arrows coming out along with the rockets will be able to maybe put some dents in the Team Liquid Academy players, but you are dealing with a Galio. You are dealing with Aatrox who can heal back up. So we'll see, especially if Viper can dominate the lane the same way he did last time against Fallen Bandits Poppy.
Yeah, I mean, we talked about CLG having what looks like a pretty strong five-man comp, but TLA, with their draft, more likely going to be trying to split the map up and make things happen in side lanes where hopefully the Varus can't get to very easily. And you can see that, no surprise, results with a TP advantage, the extra globals that Talia and Galio basically are able to take. Poppy taking the Fleet Footwork and Sorcery secondary is pretty much the standard that we saw out of the...
Wait, you mean Corki?
Did I say Corki?
I said Poppy.
I might have said Poppy. I meant Corki, no matter
okay.
what.
Okay. I was going to say, I didn't know if Fleet Footwork Poppy was actually a thing. Like, they
no.
do it in some random challenger guy in Korea does it, and I wasn't. I
no,
was at a loop. Okay.
The weird one for Poppy is Airy, usually.
Oh, for the shield harass.
Yeah, because you throw your shield, you get the Airy proc on that, it comes back, you pick your shield up. But that is not Fleet Footwork Poppy. Yordles, maybe I got them mixed in my brains, wires crossed. Either way, typical rune setup for the Corki. Nothing new, no new tech coming in.
Minions have spawned.
Just seems to be the pick that Tuesday thinks is appropriate in this composition. Does have the Fleet Footwork, like you said, plus the Sorcery. Sorcery secondary on everybody except for Phil, who is running the Inspiration. Over on the other side of the Rift, two members not running the Sorcery secondary because you've got Domination up there for Viper. Does have Sorcery primary with that Comet for more lane control. As we'll see, Team Liquid Academy move towards enemy territory level one. We haven't seen any of this in the previous two games, but when you've got Talia, who can be very obnoxious early on, firing off those threaded volleys, they decide it might be time to actually go after it here. Concussive blows will be landed onto Joey. One more auto attack will stun him up. Joey's in some trouble having a flash out. That's a summoner spell for free. going the way of CLGA.
You don't invade Braum. That's one of the kind of the rules against playing against him. He's super strong level one. Talia is also very, very strong level one, and in a fuddled kind of everyone leaving through the same path situation, you can pelt people down a lot of the time, but the rest of the team was there to support. Talia gets forced out. Joey got junked out, and Talia's going to be a little bit behind on her pathing, but she's a quick jungler, so she's probably not in too much trouble.
Joey had to chug a potion, but honestly, he's still pretty well off overall here in the bottom lane. Fallen Bandit does have the level 2 before Viper, but he's still not even winning the trades.
Right, and so this is a bit of the situation I was talking about where I was told Poppy could go aggro in the first couple of levels and actually get the shove advantage, and that looks like how Fallen Bandit decided to play it this time around once he knew that where the Talia was and that her initial path was not working out too well. So interesting to see the difference in the early laning phase up there, but we'll see if it translates towards later in the game when Fallen Bandit was perma-shoved under his turret.
Neither jungler has Smite, but Wiggly is able to make sure he secures that Scuttlecraft, stealing that one out from under the nose of Hard. Otto and Phil go for a couple of shots there onto Shoryu. Phil not too worried about the counter damage coming out just yet. Fallen Bandit continues to try to maintain pressure in this lane, but the problem is Viper can find quite a lot of damage of his own. Steadfast Presence makes sure Fallen Bandit can get out of those chains before they yoink him back. Viper is not afraid at all.
Yeah, and a bit of a scary situation there as the Poppy was...
They're also both out of items now.
Yeah, took the right path because when those chains come down, you don't want to run the long way out. You want to kind of cut perpendicular away from it, and that's exactly what he did there.
Out of items, I'm going to say out of potions. It's actually a significant advantage for Viper, who does have a real item while Poppy has an empty potion bottle. Wiggly will make his way up the top side to see if maybe there's something that can be done here. Fallen Bandit bait Viper forward. If you're Viper, you got to be thinking something funny's going on.
Pillar stun combo coming in three. There's the E.
Viper wanting to get himself away from this. Does have to flash over that pillar. Gets himself away safely for now. Chains come out. Fallen Bandit will be brought back, but it doesn't really matter too much. Not like you can go in on that 1v2.
Nope. And does illustrate our point perfectly of the correct way to try and escape the Aatrox chains. And a nice preemptive flash there by Viper. I like that he did not try anything funny because that wall stun was getting lined up by Fallen Bandit. And you can try and flash out of the stun and avoid it. But why put your reactions to the test when you just know you're going to have to flash anyways? Do it preemptively and don't risk dying. So. Good play by Viper there. Not what he wants to have to do, but you take the summoner disadvantage and you get back to lane.
Very close game early on here, as per usual. Nobody going too crazy in the first couple minutes. We haven't got to see any of those level 1, level 2 fiestas just yet. Viper with no summoner spells in the top lane. No teleport available for Fallen Bandit either. We got to see Team Liquid Academy properly punish a solo laner who had expended flash in game number 2. We'll see if CLGA can make the same thing happen here in game number 3. Remember, it becomes significantly harder to do once Viper hits 6 because he will have that second life available through the ultimate.
And a much better game for CLG against Hard, who was able to find a lot of early influence in that initial counter on the blue buff, forcing him back out of there, has seemingly really hurt his first 5 minutes where he could not get the top Scuttlecrab, which is usually something that Talia gets very frequently in her matchups because of her fast tempo clearing speed and the fact that she can harass out a lot of people with her range advantage. And to be behind 10 CS in this matchup is actually really good for CLG. Not like it's going to win the game or anything, but it's not an advantage you expect to find.
Sanity trying to find a little bit of damage on the Tuesday here in the mid lane, jumping forward to find the taunt. Tuesday not yet level 6, wants to get that so we can continue trying to control this lane a little bit better. Does now activate it as we go towards the top side again to take a look at Fallen Bandit, who's doing much better for himself this time with that aggro play style up against Viper. But now it's Hard, who makes his way into the top lane. Nice job with the Steadfast Presence, making sure he doesn't get knocked up.
Yeah, as soon as the first Viper by Hard came up a little bit short, that gank was basically dead in the water. But nice to see some pressure up there from Hard. And one final note on the Talia jungle. With the nerfs that came into Electrocute, we were talking about how it's not really a nerf for laners due to the way that they balance the numbers. Still a really big nerf for junglers because you are never going to be proccing that on cooldown. So the half cooldown and roughly half damage is just half damage now for her. And that's one of the things that made Talia so strong is when you do show up and you get your EWQ combos down, you explode somebody, and not really going to be the case.
Explosion's a little bit weaker now, as Hard not quite level 6 to make those ganks even deadlier, but at the same time, Wiggly not up to having that subjugate yet either. Piercing Arrow flies through. Otto been doing a good job with those so far this series. This is his third game of 3 on Varus.
Yeah, I mean, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. That was a little bit further of a jump than Phil thought he was going to take, as he ends up getting yoinked by Joey a little bit further. But yeah, I think the Varus pick has not been super influential in the games, but I still like what it's able to do as we see a potential play getting stuff in the bot lane.
Ooh, the flash wants to go in, looking to set up the Galio ultimate, but CLG Academy just casually steps out of it utilizing the flashes. Quite a lot of tools committed there. You can see Hard also waiting, ready to go for that with his own flash that he also used. So Team Liquid Academy goes for it, but comes up empty-handed.
Comes up empty-handed, but still a decent trade overall. 2-for-1 in the flashes and only cost you about a Galio ult. Actually, Hard also flashed in, so never mind. I take that back.
2-for-2 on flashes, and you lose the big Galio ult.
2-for-2 on flashes, you lose the Galio ult. I would still take a flash on a laner over a flash on a jungler usually, especially if you can make that play again or something similar. You can continue to try and force down around this bot lane. That's what the Galio wants to do versus the Corki, of course, is, you know, kind of trade the wave clear and then have a better ultimate and skill set for influencing side lanes. But it may come at a cost as CLG start pulling out the Infernal Drake from the pit.
CLG know their opponents have backed up in the bottom lane. They know that the Galio ultimate is down for about 3 minutes, probably 2.5 of those left now, but still not a situation the Team Liquid Academy can respond to. Excellent heads up there from CLG, recognizing, hey, this is free.
And this is also one of the times where the comps actually match up a fair amount more than we saw in the first two games. There was a bunch of tanks versus a bunch of fighters. You still have the fighter in the top lane, but outside of that, it's mostly marksman bot lane. There's still front lines for both teams, and so Infernal Drake will be very useful this game if it does go to the mid to late game and things are relatively even, given that extra stat damage. But we'll see if that's the case, because we haven't got past 28 minutes yet.
Right. These games have been ending, as you said, back in Champion Select rather quickly so far. We haven't had a game yet that's been a true war between the two sides. You don't know who's walking away until the dust settles. It was just a very convincing game one way, and an equally, if not more convincing game the other way.
Yeah, there were two opposite stomps, where it was like, two team fights, game over, versus like, a bunch of pickoffs by LeBlanc, game over.
Two different styles, two very similar results. That first game, of course, was the first time this split that CLG Academy has taken down Team Liquid Academy. Remember, they were 0-2 against TLA during the regular season.
And we'll see if they can kind of keep up this revenge tour that they're on right now in the playoffs, because according to Clutch Gaming's Rikara, or excuse me, 100 Thieves Rikara, he had never lost to CLG Academy's lineup that we talked about being together for almost 2 years now. He said he had never lost a game to them, and then they lost that series. So we'll see if they can make the same thing true against TLA.
Joey takes a little bit of damage down here on the bottom side, but that Pyke passive, so very effective at clearing that away, making sure not a lot of it sticks, and Joey will remain mostly healthy. Relic Shield will continue topping him off as the cannon minion approaches the lane. Looking in on the farm, because I want to compare it to where it's been the past couple of games, where we've seen massive leads for Team Liquid Academy in both the solo lanes, dead even, top and middle. Bottom lane, actually the biggest CS difference so far this game, with Shoryu having about a 10 advantage over Otto. Joey goes for the hook, does find that bone skewer onto Phil, but you're not going to follow up on a Braum, not underneath his turret anyway.
Probably not.
I would hope not.
I would, unless you had a lot of backup coming real soon, I would definitely.
Unless you have 6 dudes ready and raring to go.
Which is impossible.
Correct.
Ah.
I don't like watching people dive Braum.
Well, you might have to watch it, unfortunately, in a second here. Hard's hovering and Galio has priority mid lane, but there is a ward on him, so they are aware that the potential dive could come in, and Hard is instead focusing down the scuttle crab. It doesn't look like that dive is actually going to happen.
CLG knows something could be going on, though. They will send Wiggly down towards this bottom side as Phil and Otto hang back just out of vision range to make sure that...
Does he know that ward's there?
Nobody's planning anything. He might.
No, okay. I thought it was like kind of showing off, recalling exactly on top of the ward, but no. It looked like he was just not aware of that. As Insanity is also on a ward.
Tuesday also has the package. So does have the opportunity to make something happen with that one, but when he takes half his HP and damage from Insanity, that's not going to go too well. Does use the package there to get out of the way of the seismic shove, and
That's a pretty important cooldown down.
Yeah, it's definitely not game-changing, but not insignificant either to be able to force out a pretty powerful cooldown out of Corki for a simple Taliyah W. Nice job by Insanity kind of baiting that extended trade.
And that's something that back in the days of Corki meta was very prevalent. It's something that we talked about a lot was whenever you hear the alarm of the package as the team against the Corki, you have to play around the fact that he can use that, come into a fight from a long way away, especially in a jungle fight. In something with tight corridors, it's absolutely devastating. And up against this Corki that has now fallen out of the meta, something that you aren't as used to playing against, I want to see if CLG can find the opportunity to take TLA by surprise and really use one of those packages to turn a team fight that otherwise might not have gone so well.
Exactly. And I think that's a big part of hopefully what the coaching staff would do going into the game. Hey guys, haven't played against Corki in a while. When you hear that big ol' alarm, do not fight until you know where he is, and then make sure you're taking intelligent fights knowing that he can't collapse. So it is fortunately one of the champions with a big ol' reminder, like we said, if there is going to be a situation where it packs up.
Topside, hard, thinking about the gank on the Fallen Bandit. The chains come through, but Fallen Bandit has the steadfast presence. He knows he can get out of the chain and subsequently the seismic shove. TLA's gank isn't going to get him a whole lot.
This is a situation now where hard has had a really difficult time getting involved in any sort of action early on compared to the previous game where, as great as Insanity played, you could almost give the player of the game to hard for setting up everything that happened and working with the mid laner. Definitely a bit of a come-down game for both the mid and the jungler, not finding anything early on.
Of course, it is a lot harder to gank Corki than it is pre-6 cast as well. Makes life a little bit more difficult overall. Infernal Drake number 2 spawning in 55 seconds. I would expect the teams would deem that worthy to fight over.
I would hope Beck so as well. A lot of it will probably come down to pre-fight setup, making sure you have good vision so that no one's going to surprise you. There are a lot of pickoff tools on both sides. If Fallen Bandit can get a TP flank, that's massive. You always have the Flash Varus ultimate to start a fight. On the flip side, Pyke and Taliyah. So we'll see what they choose to do. As here we go, maybe bot lane.
One great way to start off a fight near the Drake is to make sure you can pick off the enemy bottom lane first. Instead, it's going to be Joey taken down. First blood over to Otto. Viper makes the TP into the back lines as Phil tries to get himself away with a flash again, trying to dodge, duck, dip, dive, and dodge, but he can't quite do it. Fallen Bandit having a flash out of the way now, as well as Insanity makes his entrance into the fight in a heroic way. Tuesday hovering off to the side, trying to find some damage onto Hard on the back end of the fight. Has to fly back over the wall, though. The chains are going to pull him back. Viper finds some damage over the wall. Not a ton just yet, though. TLA did go 2-for-1 in the fight. Now looking to go after the Drake. But CLG knows that they can force them away from this one. They have the TP available. There are low health bars on the side of TLA. Otto's made his way back into the mix. Insanity still full HP. Wiggly still hanging around. Tuesday still down. As Insanity will now be on the front line. Also going to be tanking up the Drake there as Fallen Bandit now gives him his life over as well. The Drake goes over to the side of CLG Academy, but at what cost? Otto very low, a double kill over for Hard. Wiggly has to limp out of this one. TLA will be very happy with the overall results of this super extended fight.
That was such a difficult contest by CLG. I thought the idea of it made sense, but just not quite clean enough on the execution as TLA were able to re-engage and get 2 more kills. Wiggly did secure the Drake for themselves. That feels like a bit too heavy of a cost, as now not only do they give up a ton of kills and a gold lead, the turrets are soon to fall as well.
First turret goes over to the side of Team Liquid Academy. That jumps the gold up even further. Woo. What is it with these Drake fights that always ends up in such a slaughter for one side? Let's take another look at it from the beginning.
I mean, it starts with the hook onto Otto, which sets Joey up for the flash E to make sure that I can get both of them. Phil does not flash it, and they turn onto Joey, which is nice, but now they're caught in the lane with Viper having a great ward to TP in from behind. They get Phil, but it does cost them a lot of resources, and they start getting low. The Galley ult has to come out, the Lee ult comes out, Corki makes his way down there, and so it's a 2-for-1 at this point. The TP coming in makes them think, okay, they're pretty low, they've used all their cooldowns, if we TP back in, we can probably contest this. So I can definitely see what CLG's thinking, but as this actually plays out, they definitely just walk too far forward. The fact that Viper, with his extended range on his passive auto attack, will have the burst required to finish off Fallen Bandit, I believe it is, when he walks back forward. Or it's just Tuesday. Oh god, so much damage there. The EQ from Viper to start that out with the auto attack is kind of what enabled that to work in their favor. Now they're trying it on the Galio.
Jumping on Galio can be a lot like jumping on Braum.
Yeah.
Not the best.
Three-man taunt, walks on out of there. Nothing
you get the aftershock as well as soon as the taunt goes off. The follow-up's just not going to be able to burst you down through that one. Sanity walks away just fine. As Phil, even on the Braum, not tanky enough to survive this one. Shoryu grabs the kill credit. That's number 6 for TLA.
Yeah, Phil keeps getting hit by these pikeys. That time, it was followed up with the Taliyah damage. And when we talk about the LSQ nerf, but it's still a big chunk. And with that, the game is starting to feel like it's slipping away from CLG Academy up to about a 3,500 gold lead. Rift Herald soon to follow. Two turrets left in the side lanes that they can very quickly break, assuming they can keep this tempo up. And Sandy's ult's back available. Hard's ult back available. So I would expect another big play in the top lane real soon.
And let's see how fast this game starts to get out of control, because the previous games have done so very, very quickly. Sometimes all you need is that one catalyst fight to really turn things around. And we already commented back in game one about how both of these teams seem to be two of the better squads in terms of the overall teamwork and team play in the Academy League. So if they've got those elements down pat, they can sure enough translate such a lead into a victory.
And this is a time where their comp really does work together. Game one was a bunch of melee fighters who want to dive a backline. There's really not too much you need to communicate and synergize on other than when to go and when not to go. And we saw CLG handling that fine. These team fights and map plays available with their comp kind of showing why TLA matches up so well against CLG Academy is because, hey, let's force a 5-man bot play with all our global advantages on it, and let's execute on it super well. And these are the kinds of things a lot of Academy teams will struggle with, which is why TLA is such a fearsome opponent.
Wiggly now in some trouble, caught out by two, make it three as Insanity Yikes. Grabs the kill credit with assists going over to both Joey and Hard. All right, when your Trundle can easily just be caught out like that, that feels pretty bad, because that means nobody's going to be safe.
Yeah, losing control of mid lane pressure, Galio can be wherever he wants to be and just taunts up the guy in the river. Now going top.
Speaking of top, one problem that I'm noticing so far for CLG Academy here this game, look at the itemization on Fallen Bandit. He's got the Sunfire Cape, he's got the Tabbies, he's got a Sheen, which lends me to believe he's going to be going for Iceborne. But yeah, you're up against Viper. That's very necessary against Viper. AP jungler, AP mid laner, AD carry that happens to do a lot of AP damage thanks to the way Plasma works. This Poppy is deceptively squishy when it comes to these team fights.
Yeah, gonna be just fine in the side lane, but like you said, if we keep getting these big break and bot lane dives, we'll have a hard time doing something about it. But they have other problems too, of course. The fact that they have a 2-kill Taliyah, 2-kill Aatrox means that they're gonna be able to really take over some of these team fights. That's the scary thing about Aatrox, not just his split push pressure, which is obviously sometimes very substantial, but when he pops his ultimate, the ability to just kind of dive into backlines and buy so much space for your team is absolutely terrifying.
The anti-death passive so incredibly strong on this guy in order to make these plays happen in a way that facilitate TLA just going all in with the lead they've built. 5,000 gold ahead of their opponents right now, 20 minutes into the game. Baron is now live. Third Infernal Drake in a row.
Let's go, this game.
Spawning in 45. League of Legends itself wants each subsequent game to be faster than the previous one.
And you're talking about these dragon fights that are ending the game and big ol' 5v5s over them. That's how League used to be played. You know, you spent a fair amount of time during that pause in game one reminiscing over those days. And this game is playing out very much like those old days where Drake spawns, everyone gets themselves in position, and whoever can execute that 5v5 team fight better, gonna walk away.
CLG Academy still hanging around this mid lane, still trying to push up. You got your Trinity Force with a Zeal working towards most likely a rapid fire cannon or a static shift on the side of Tuesday, but Fallen Bandit's on the front line. He's not gonna be on that line much longer if he keeps taking damage like that.
That's that magic damage poke you're talking about, mostly coming in from Taliyah and the Kai'Sa.
And look at Taliyah's itemization. It's the very standard Taliyah build. But wait, we got a fight breaking out. We don't got time for items. Phil's gonna be on the front line. Shut down Predator over to Tuesday, taking down that enemy jungler. As now the Void Seeker comes out, nearly gonna find Phil on that one. Winds of War will blow, finds their way onto the enemy support. TLA still looking to continue this fight. Shoryu goes on a killing spree, grabbing the kill onto Wiggly. Fallen Bandit now looking to tank up the front lines. Viper taking low, taking down. Shoryu looking to get himself away, but Tuesday's got the guns, baby. Mows him over with a Gatling gun, grabs the shutdown for himself, and CLGA take 4-for-2.
Fire back at the third Drake. These Infernal Dragons starting to come online. 20 minutes of the game, backline was protected that entire time in that fight as frontline damage was traded out. And of course, CLG have the better frontline. So they were able to win that fight pretty convincingly with some nice execution as well as they got in there at different times as Joey.
Oh!
Not sure was worth trying to steal with his ultimate there.
I don't
mull that one over. We'll take another look at this fight. And, you know, it's a great start of a trade onto Phil. They chunk him out super hard, but at this point, they just get a little bit too far forward. This is after the initial trade, excuse me. And Viper gets his Resurrect passive off, but he didn't stack it very much, so he comes back at, you know, about a fifth of his HP. Insanity gets a nice first kill, but Fallen Bandit finds the angle back into this fight, and they get the chase down kills. So we're talking about good old League of Legends, the Drake 5v5s. So that's what these games come down to. And now CLG Academy with three Infernal Drakes, despite how bad this game was looking when it was a 4K gold lead to like 18 minutes in the game. Three Infernal Drakes at this point in the game completely offsets any deficit they're sitting at.
Good lord, man. Look at the damage. 7,500 combined between Otto and Tuesday. You talked about the poke power of these two champions when we saw them drafted for the side of CLGA this game. Well, that's what happens when these guys get to stay at range, get to pour damage into the Team Liquid Academy lines. You find success like that, you find numbers like that, you find your Corki completing his rapid fire cannon, getting a BF sword on top of it. This guy is a serious threat.
Yeah, I mean, this damage number is going to keep ticking up for the back line, and they want these really standard, classic front-to-back team fights. We got triple tank plus two marksmen, one of them doing magic damage, and it's going to fall on TLA to disrupt that team fight pattern. As Joey... a little scary there, but he has the double pink ward to make sure he's safe walking forward. No vision over the wall for CLG is, well, as I say that.
Oh, but the chains of corruption come down and Joey goes bye-bye as CLG Academy finds themselves 1-0. Fallen Bandit takes some damage in the exchange, but he'll be just fine as they walk their way up towards the Baron. See control wards put down all throughout this area. It's just a holy line of vision for CLG Academy as they move up towards the top side. Insanity looks to jump himself away. Wiggly makes the flash pillar so they can find the collapse. Now onto the TLA mid laner. Aftershock still going to be proc, keeping him alive for now. Stopwatch comes out, just buying enough time, looking to get away. Still not going to be able to do it. And CLGA gets 2-0 on the overall extended play here, but it is their mid lane.
Ooh.
That now is taken over by the side of TLA. A very nice block on the Weaver's wall from Phil is gonna make it so CLGA is not stopped from getting to Baron in time. And now Team Liquid Academy has to surrender that priority they worked for here in the mid lane. Fallen Bandit looking to find the knockback, keep their opponents away. Hard's not gonna be able to get it over to Baron in time. Fallen Bandit is the noble sacrifice, but what more has to be sacrificed here and now? Joey's gonna be taken down. Viper on the front lines with the chains. Otto goes down next. They still have Tuesday firing, but no mana on a Corki is not a situation you stick around for voluntarily. Hard sidesteps his way away from the concussive blows. The winner's
bottom.
Tuesday says, what's up, buddy? I still got auto attack items.
And CLG are able to skirt out of that. They do lose two members, but they're more than happy to grab the Drake, or the Baron, excuse me, off the back of that play. Really intelligent play by both teams here. Body are blocking that Taliyah ult to make sure that they still had access to the Baron pit, which forced TLA to stop trying to trade out for the mid turret and instead contest this. But Fallen Bandit goes, makes a beeline for the Taliyah to kick her out of that fight. Sure, he does get the cleanup kill, but it secured the Baron for his team. And now the rest of TLA wants to just get as aggressive as possible and take as many Baron buffs off this team as they can. They find Otto, but sure, you did not want to keep kiting forward with the Aatrox. Maybe if all three kited forward together and the reviving Aatrox bought space for Shoryu to continue to walk forward and they were more on the same page, they can get at least one more kill there. But the miscommunication you see starting to get to Joey, at least, as TLA very frustrated with this game, slipping away from them after having such a fantastic start.
I mean, honestly, the start was phenomenal for this team. That Drake play that CLG was able to find the second Infernal Drake but ultimately gave up so many kills for just seemed like it had set things in motion. They get the Rift Herald right after, they push up the mid lane, they get the first turret blood bottom side, everything's going their way. And then the 4-for-2 fight in the Team Liquid Academy jungle just says, nope, swinging back the other way. And now CLG Academy feels like they're in such a good spot. They do still have Baron up and running on multiple members. The gold is still in the favor of TLA, but we've got to keep in mind those three fire symbols underneath the CLG banner. It accounts for so much unspoken gold that they have a significant advantage as they push up with Baron buff here in the top lane.
And that gold lead's not going to last for very long. They're going to drop this top lane tower in a second here. TLA trying to put up a fight, but as soon as that Winds of War is down and the haunt's blue, there's nothing they can do.
Fallen Bandit going into the front line, going to be taken very low, taken down. Zonya's stopwatch is everything coming out. Insanity taken low, also going to be going down next. Viper into the front lines, trying to tank everybody up, seeing if he can maybe make the magic happen. Otto's nearly going to die now too, but instead he's going to be kept alive, finding himself a double kill. As CLG Academy looks to finish this one off hard and shore you alive, but Tuesday says not for long. Gives him the spatula and sends him right back to the spawn platform. First class, baby. Hard trying to keep himself alive, be the last man standing here in this defense. But Tuesday has blocked the way out. He's sidestepped the seismic shove. The burn won't burn him away, but it still keeps him low enough to allow CLGA plenty of time on the inhibitor. They'll now move on to the Nexus turrets. Tuesday almost gives away the final kill there to that Nexus turret. But with only Hard left standing, Joey coming up in 1 second, CLG will find the first comeback win of the series and go up 2-1.
That Corki popped off 7-1-5 for Tuesday when we haven't seen the Corki in quite some time, quickly showing its value in this game. And that was a back and forth game that swung out of nowhere when it felt like TLA was completely running away with it.
What an incredible amount of damage done by Tuesday in that game. 22,800 damage compared to the next highest in the game was 17,500 from his own AD carry.
Yeah, I mean, that was such a weird game to talk about because so much stuff was going well for TLA and that second Infernal Drake that Wiggly was able to smite but killed two more of his members for. At the time, we're both looking at that like, that's really not worth it. Like, nice that you got that Drake, but if you find one fight and can stabilize the game from there, which they did, suddenly that second Infernal Drake is so worth the 600 gold that you lost for it.
Right, when you think about the difference in comparing the stats between a 2-1 Drake split and a 3-0, it's 24% bonus compared to 0% bonus, or 16 compared to 8, which doesn't feel flashy or shiny at all.
Right, yeah, and that becomes huge once you hit 25 minutes and you have 2.5, 3 items available for your carries. And, you know, hats off to CLG because not only did they find that one fight and then kind of come back in the game, but they actually played it super smart from then on. And that one Baron situation as well kind of spoke to the fact that they were not, you know, losing their focus despite how bad that game was going.
This series just keeps going blow for blow for blow. CLG does great. Team Liquid does great. Team Liquid seemingly does great again. But as I said, this is the first comeback win. This is the first time we've really seen it swing over, and it still ended before 30 minutes.
That plus the fact that, once again, the team that's going into the next match with side selection is the winner. So we might see Red Side CLG for the fourth game in a row. And whenever you have one of these strategies, like, someone's wrong, right? Like,
right.
Someone's strategy is losing to the other team's strategy. So we'll have to see if CLG's all red side is going to pay off in this best of five.
Who knows? We'll find out here in a little while. But for more on the game we just watched, let's send it down to the analyst desk.
Thank you very much, Captain Flowers. And what a wonderful toss that was. There's the draft very soon. First, it's our names. Still Freak, Balfrost, and Zyrene. Y'all are wonderful. There's the draft.
Drafted to the desk.
My own fault. It didn't tell me we're going to get our names down there. I blame the prompter. No, you guys are wonderful. I apologize. I never would say anything bad about you. Either way, the draft was a pretty cool one. As the casters talked about, more red side for CLG. Another Aatrox Poppy counterpick. This time they brought out Corki mid, and a very interesting game it was.
Yeah, they definitely opted for a more teamfight comp in terms of like CLG's team comp, where they picked Corki. He's like a really good scaling champion, and you just have a lot of presence in, like, once you get your first item, your Trinity Force, and they just have still the Varus and the Braum, so that's like a really stable pick, it seems like, for CLG, and they probably want to split those champions up.
Yeah, and TLA, they went with Aatrox, Pyke, Kai'Sa, and then they were picking Taliyah for the jungle, so the Galio comes in as like the sole tank of the composition, and I felt like that was kind of, it set up the Corki to have lane priority, it set up the Corki to pretty much have a free matchup. He even took Cole because it was so easy for him, and that gave him priority. It ultimately made it so that they could control the early parts of the game with the Infernal Drakes. And because they were Infernal Drakes, it helped him out later. And that's kind of the thing I'm getting at here is like the Drake stacking really did help the CLG a lot because when they hit those mid-game fights and they had two of them, it's the difference maker.
Yeah, so this is one where they're able to get it really, really cleanly. Corki had priority for their bottom lane, and this kind of has been keep happening throughout the series. It feels like CLG has given a lot of these objectives kind of for free. Then we have that the mid lane fight. And yeah, Joey pulling in Braum, maybe an oopsie there.
Yeah, I mean, you can't know everybody who's in the bushes and stuff like that. I mean, incomplete vision and information. But he pulls in the Braum looking for a different target. And then it just becomes this staggered fight where they're actually on the losing end of this. And then the Infernal Drake goes over. But Joey, I feel like he had three back-to-back pretty bad plays. And you can even see it on his face later with the react that he was not in a good spot there mentally after kind of the first two mistakes and then the third one coming in.
I think him going for this steal is a little bit ambitious.
Yeah, basically.
It's kind of going for a meta play, it might work.
So I would actually argue that because the CLG jungler is dead, you're going for your ult against their damage, and one kill compared to, let's say, a 15% chance at Drake, I would argue it's worth trying, even though it's gonna fail more often than not. I think the gains outweigh the losses. You might disagree. Being off map for a while can certainly hurt map control and whatnot, but I think it's at least a debatable attempt at a steal. Again, you're welcome to disagree here. Either way, you see the gold graph sealed down quite a lot. Looking at like a 5,500 gold lead, and it just turned right back around. As you saw, huge damage out of the Corki, pretty big damage out of the Varus as well. Really good sort of team effort to get themselves into the team fights.
Yeah, this game was like the Tuesday show where he just came back from the previous game where he had a really bad performance. But this game, he was just going off in team fights. He was dealing like a lot of damage and he was just going off.
I love when he got up after the game. Like you could tell he was having a good time on that Corki. Pretty much untouched, took cleanse, so you couldn't reach him really in any of these fights. Yeah. And he had a good front line of a Braum, a Trundle, and a Poppy. Like, it's pretty much an ideal composition to be playing a Corki. Sure, you're playing into the Galio, so he's gonna absorb some of your damage, but Galios don't really go mega tanky anymore. It's like the semi AP since the AP ratio changes. So Adaptive Helm isn't like an early purchase for him. It's like Rod of Ages, Zhonya's, and then you go from there. Sure. So he is actually feeling quite good in the matchup and gets to dictate it for a long time. And you could see after he got two items and those power spikes for Corki that it was the Tuesday show, like you were saying.
Yeah, I do think as far as Midland is concerned though, I saw a lot of mistakes out of Insanity. I saw two fights in a row where he goes for the flash taunt with zero follow-up. Mm-hmm. He goes in there, he like lands in, and is like, yeah, slam the ground. I'm like, cool, that's 300 damage. And then he like walks backwards as the Corki's like shooting at him the whole time. And I'm like, are you not aware like of what your team comp is? Like Kai'Sa R is already down. Like, she's not gonna jump into four people with a Braum with a shield ready. So I feel like there were a lot of individual mistakes. I know Joey's someone that we can give a lot of flack towards. It felt like, and he was feeling it as well. Again, you mentioned the reaction where he's like just head in hand, just like, you know, really upset about it. But I saw a lot of individual misplays on TLA.
Yeah, and you were talking about like the composition for them, where you were saying, do you know where your composition is once you go for that slam with Galio? Their composition is side lane control. They have Galio, Talia. You can pivot from there, but you're being pushed in by the Corki the entire time, and the Talia wasn't going mid, freeing up the Galio, and then double roaming to either the Aatrox or going to the opposite side for the Pike, right? It didn't seem like there was a system to the way that they were roaming. And that's something that I think they would have to work out, is figure out who's getting freed up by the Talia. Because we saw him go bottom, and then maybe Pyke was roaming around. That was kind of what Joey was going for. Yep. But there were a lot of mistakes that happened around the mid lane because they weren't able to get pressure and see kind of everything around there, right? Because if you're in the losing matchup, less vision control, less deeper wards, and then that's where they get caught off guard before the fights.
Okay, so 2-1, CLG with side choice. They've picked red side. They are one win away from advancing to the finals.